Good morning and welcome to worship this morning. It's good to have you here on this 10th Sunday after Pentecost. A few announcements. Stay tuned to the various announcements via email and the website and all regarding masks. We're feeling safe, but we know this is a fluid situation and things are changing all the time. You know, our policy is if you're fully vaccinated, you don't have to wear a mask. If you're unvaccinated, please, please, please wear a mask. Please try to encourage all your friends and family members who are not vaccinated to do so. It's a safe way to go. Our monarch is here. It's on the literature table to the left as you're leaving. The first new disciples class that we've had in a long time will be gathering together on September 25th, so you could see Pastor Sarah or myself about that. And I'd like to invite Sue Connor forward, and she's going to share with us something about the community of St. Dismas, our prison congregation in the Delaware, Maryland Synod. Hi, Sue.
Good morning. Good morning. I'm here to ask you to help me out with what's going to be a really short project, but will mean a lot to some people. As you know, probably, Salem has long supported the community of St. Dismas. And we are currently represented by Pastor Susan Beck, whose office is here at Salem. The community of St. Dismas has been mailing devotional and Bible study materials to the inmates at various prisons for some time now, and some of us in the congregation are writing letters. Mail is particularly important right now to the inmates because they're still in lockdown. They've been in lockdown for the whole duration of the pandemic, and when we started easing up, they did not. So they're still totally locked down. And I'm currently writing to a specific woman who's in her 70s. She's been incarcerated for almost 40 years. And she's feeling very isolated, particularly now. And one thing that helps her is mail. So she tells me how much my letters mean. And she would like to write more letters, you know, to family and friends. But stamps are very, very difficult for them to get. And so I'm asking you that during this month of August, if you would go to the post office and get a sheet of stamps. This is the $11 sheet of 20 first class forever stamps. And put them in the box that's out there in the foyer. And this would mean so much to these people who are in prison right now. And a good reason to do this right now is because postage stamps are going up the end of August. So this is a good time for you to run to the post office and get all your stamps. And please pick up an extra one for St. Dismas. And in the words of this woman who writes to me, this is how she closes her letter. Peace and love to you. May your day be filled with love. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sue. Thank you. A wonderful cause. Thanks. Make mention, too, Lutheran World Relief, LWR, will be collecting school supplies, things like notebooks and pens and pencils. There's a blurb in the bulletin about that, so we'll be doing that for how long, Vicki? All through the month of August, okay? So school supplies. A couple of big thank yous. A big thank you for everyone who donated last week to Catonsville Emergency Assistance, CEA, our local food pantry. We gathered hundreds of pounds of food that we took down to CEA at 25 Bloomsbury. And we collected over $2,000 in contributions. And of course, though they're celebrating Christmas in July for these 12 days starting last Sunday, this is, of course, a year-round effort. So you can always bring food, put it in the brown wicker basket, and of course, they always would gladly accept donations. You can use a green pew envelope to do that. But thank you so much for your generosity last week. And a big thank you to our Salem Drama Camp. We had a wonderful, wildly successful drama camp these past 3 weeks. Thursday and Friday, they had their play, It's Cool in the Furnace, and it was a very cool play. It was wonderful music, wonderful acting. The children worked really hard, and it obviously paid off, and we know they had great fun too. So thank you to Anita Lane, and thank you Marley Toscano and Melissa Miller and Abby Hoffman, their helpers. So it was great. Are there any other announcements that need to come before us this morning? All right, very good. Well, I invite you to please stand as you're able for worship.
The gift of peace through our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God poured into our hearts, and the renewing spirit of grace, the Holy Spirit, be with you all.
And also with you.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, and the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. You may kneel or be seated. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe that there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen. Please rise as you are able.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. O God, eternal goodness, immeasurable love, you place your gifts before us. We eat and are satisfied. Fill us in this world, in all its need, with the life that comes only from you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
A reading from Ephesians, starting at the first verse. Therefore, the prisoner in the Lord beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it is said, when he ascended on high, he made captivity itself a captive. He gave gifts to his people. When it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens so that he might fill all things. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ until all of us come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness in deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building and itself up in love. Word of God, word of life, thanks be to God.
We will read Psalm 78 responsively. So God commanded the clouds above and opened the doors of heaven, raining down manna upon them to eat, and giving them grain from heaven. So mortals ate the bread of angels. God provided for them food enough. The Lord caused the east wind to blow in the heavens and powerfully led out the south wind, raining down flesh upon them like dust and flying birds like the sand of the seas, letting them fall in the midst of the camp and round about the dwellings. So the people ate and were filled, for God gave them what they craved. Please rise as you're able for the Holy Gospel.
Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 6th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. When the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were beside the sea, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly, I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." And Jesus said to them, "Very truly, I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. The congregation may be seated and invite our young friends forward for our children's time.
Good morning, everyone, and good morning to our friends up here. Hi, Mikey. And to all the kids who are at home, good to see everyone here today. My name is Miss Vicki, and this is my sister, Miss Linda. And today, we are going to show you some things that you use for measuring, okay? So, Miss Linda's going to pull some things out, and as she pulls them out and shows them to you, try to guess what you would use those to measure.
What would you measure with this? You see? Paper, yes. You would use this in school, and it tells you how many inches you can measure on this. Absolutely. Okay. How about this? What does this look like? Absolutely. You use it to fill up an amount of water, or if you're measuring things to cook with, you would use this for that. Okay. Now, what is sitting on the floor in front of me? Who can knows what that is? It's something to tell your weight. It measures your weight. Now, Miss Vicki and I are absolutely not going to get on that.
Actually, I think Pastor Dave was going to demonstrate that part for us. Kidding.
Okay.
So, if you had to pick which one of these items would measure God's love, which one would you pick? Do you think any of those could measure God's love? Right, probably not. Okay. But we have one more thing, and this measures really long.
Really long.
So maybe this would measure God's love.
Okay.
Okay. So Miss Linda is going to walk this down. Let's see how far this can go. Okay. Maybe this would be long enough to measure God's love.
I know. This goes way far.
What do we think? What do we think?
Okay.
It's pretty long. Pretty
long.
Yep. That's about 25 feet.
Yeah.
What do you think?
I don't know about this.
Does that measure God's love? Yep, I think you're right, it doesn't.
Okay.
So I think that means that God's love really is not measurable, is it?
Okay.
Because God's love is so big, and it surrounds us so much,
there.
And it's so everywhere around that we just can't measure it. So what we can do, though, is be grateful and talk to God and pray to God and let him know how much we love him back. So let's bow our heads and say a prayer.
Heavenly Father, we are so very grateful that you love us more than we can measure. Thank you for always being with us, for listening to our prayers, and for letting us be here today. We pray that you would help us to love you and other people more than we can measure. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thanks for coming up.
Vicki and Linda, thank you for that. By the way, tomorrow work begins on the renovation of Reformation Hall, so they may need you with that tape measure back there. Huh? Yeah, yeah. God's grace, mercy, and peace be with you this day. Amen. The consumers are coming. The consumers are coming. The crowds of people have once again found Jesus. Last week, we heard the story of Jesus feeding a huge crowd on a grassy hillside with two fish and five loaves of barley bread, with plenty left over. That was followed by his mysterious walking on water appearance to the disciples as they were floundering in a boat during a violent storm. This week, the crowd has followed Jesus around the Sea of Galilee to a new location. The crowd is struggling with what happened, thus a barrage of questions for Jesus. The crowd wants to know when Jesus came to the other side of the lake. Jesus makes no mention of walking on water, and the answer he gives is a complicated response about the people not seeing the signs, that is, miracles, for what they are, but their desire to be filled with food. In other words, they are just a crowd of consumers. The crowd wants to know what they can do to work God's work. And Jesus' response is about believing rather than working. The crowd asks for a miracle from Jesus so that they can believe. Why don't you make like Moses, Jesus? Jesus answers by telling them they have it all wrong. It wasn't Moses that fed the Israelites in the desert with manna. It was God. Did you notice the grammar Jesus employs? He says, "But it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven." Present tense, gives. God is giving. God is sustaining them. God, not Moses, is the subject of the sentence. The crowd demands, rather than ask for, demands bread. Jesus says, "I am the bread of life." I don't know about you, but I find this whole exchange just a bit confusing. The crowd wants to know something, and Jesus answers by presenting different kinds of information. The people ask for signs and bread, and Jesus talks about faith. Jesus knows why the crowds are there, and it wasn't for spiritual or religious reasons. So here's my question for you. Can we consume religion or spirituality just like we consume goods and services? Is Salem and all the other churches up and down Frederick Road akin to Wegmans and Catonsville Gourmet and Target just another place to have your needs met? Do you come here to get your spiritual needs met? Is it Salem's job here to fill hungry spiritual stomachs? It is the church's mission to fill the spiritual needs of the people, and even to help the people with their physical needs. It's difficult to think spiritual thoughts when your stomach is growling. It's hard to think about spiritual matters when you're living on the street or have no money to pay for your medical expenses. Jesus did not neglect the physical hunger or suffering of the people as he preached the good news to them, and we in the church should follow his example. Well, that's what CEA and Lutheran Rural Relief, that's what it's all about, isn't it? But back to the question about spiritual needs. If part of the church's mission is to address our spiritual needs, then does that make us religious consumers? No, it doesn't. For to be a consumer is a one-way street. You're searching for the best deal, the lowest price, the right product or service, right? But you see, when you are part of the church, you are much more than a consumer because you are the church. You are the body of Christ. We are the church. We are the body of Christ. We are not consumers. We are followers of Jesus planted in this place and in this time. We are placed here in fellowship with each other, woven together in a rich tapestry of relationship. We are knit together in community. That said, there are needs that each of us has. We come to this nave on Sunday mornings, or maybe we're participating online this morning. We come here for many reasons, but I would suggest to you that most of those motivations and impulses could be described in one word: edification. We come here to be edified, to be built up, to be strengthened, to be nourished. We can come here when we are happy and when we are sad. Oh, and let us be careful to never be happy church, you know, that kind of sugary church gathering where everyone is happy all the time, where we never confront tragedy or conflict or doubt. We should strive to be joyful community, yet at the same time, make sure that there's a place for those who are mourning and grieving, for those who are questioning, and for those who wonder why and how they even got out of bed this morning. We come here to give as well as receive. You will never know the kind word that you may have said this morning, the warm welcome that you shared with a visitor, the smile you offered a fellow disciple, and how it made someone's day, helped someone to hang on when they felt they could not. We are not consumers. We are an imperfect community striving to follow Jesus. We are pilgrims on a journey of faith. In the words of 1 Peter, we are living stones, a chosen community, a royal priesthood, God's very own people. We are stewards of the mysteries of God. And in the commendation at the grave, which we pronounce when laying our dear saints to rest, we state clearly who we disciples of Jesus are when it is spoken, we are sheep of his own fold, lambs of his own flock, sinners of his own redeeming. We come here because God is the subject of our lives, not the object. God is the subject. We don't come here to consume God. We come here to listen and to worship and praise God and give thanks to God, because even in the midst of trouble and heartache and tragedy, and in the midst of good times and success and much happiness, God is always giving and sustaining us with the bread of life. Jesus. The crowds had it all wrong. They were looking for stuff. They were looking for someone with all the answers. The church does not have all the answers. I do not have all the answers. No one can explain to us the mass killings. No one can explain drunken drivers killing innocent people. No one can explain why our loved ones sometimes leave us way too soon. We will always be hungry for answers and explanations that the church does not have. And no authority, no philosophy, no religion has all of those answers. Our spiritual hunger brings us here, the hunger to be edified, to be built up, strengthened, and nourished. For you see, what Jesus was telling the crowds is the same message for you and me today. It's not about stuff. It's not about consumption. It's about a relationship with God, our relationship with God and with each other. Jesus is God's love revealed. That is what our being here is about. To believe in Jesus, to experience God's love in the proclamation of the word and in the breaking of the bread together. The only food that can satisfy our hunger, the only food that can last for all time, is the bread of life, Jesus himself, God's true gift to us. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Sing to the Lord, come.
invite you to please stand as you're able. Together, let us share our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father, and he come again, living the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Rejoicing in the good news of the resurrection, let us pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. Gracious God, you call us into relationship with you through Christ Jesus. Thank you for the signs, the miracles, the blessings in our lives. We pray that we would respond to your saving grace with lives of faithful and loving service. Lord, in your mercy. O God, you call your church to be the body of Christ. Awaken all the baptized to the gifts you provide for our work of ministry. Where the church is divided, knit us together and restore our unity in Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator God, you created, and it was good. Inspire us to be caring stewards of the planet, to regenerate the forests, to safeguard species at risk of extinction, and strengthen the work of conservation organizations around the world. Lord, in your mercy, O God, you summon the leaders of the world to respond to the needs of your people. Instill in those who govern integrity and honesty and perseverance in seeking what promotes the well-being of the community. Lord, in your mercy, compassionate God, you draw near to those who cry out for help. May we feed the hungry, reassure those who are despairing, and accompany those who are imprisoned. Rain down the bread of heaven that gives life to the world. We pray for the end of the pandemic. We lift up to you all who this day are hospitalized in rehab, recovering at home, or awaiting surgery. For whom shall we pray this day? We remember in our prayers, too, Miriam Anderson, Linda Bell, Char Brooks, George Bergtorf, Sherry Kravitz, Greg Rotz, Marilyn Timmel, Kathy Zink, Betty Spittle. We pray for Jennifer Bates, Barb Meyer's daughter, who will be having a partial knee replacement. We pray for Marcia Foss's sister, Marilyn, for her upcoming back surgery. We give thanks and rejoice with Alyssa Kaplan, who received the church's gift of ordination to word and sacrament ministry. Pastor Kaplan has been called to be the mission developer of St. Peter's Church in East Point, and we pray blessing upon her ministry there. And we rejoice with Eric Amros and Liz Argento, who were married earlier this month. May God grant them much happiness in all the years ahead. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O God, you provide food that endures for eternal life. Sustain each of us this day with the bread of life until we are gathered with all the saints and feast together at your heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy, We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. And let the people of God say,
Amen.
And now the peace of the Lord be with you always. Thank you. Let's share God's peace with one another. God's peace. God's peace. God's peace. Just a reminder that the offering plate is in back in front of the baptismal font. Thank you for all our friends at home who support us electronically and by sending checks through the mail. We appreciate your generosity. And let us pray our offering prayer together. Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, you have set this table with your very self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body for the life of the world. Amen.
Please rise as you're able. The Lord is with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymns. O God, most merciful, O God, our rock and our salvation, hear us as we praise, call us to your table, grant us your life. When the world was a formless void, you formed order and beauty. When Abraham and Sarah were barren, you sent them a child. When the Israelites were enslaved, you led them to freedom. Ruth faced starvation, David fought Goliath, and the psalmists cried out for healing. And full of compassion, you granted the people your life. You entered our sorrows in Jesus, our brother, who was born among the poor, who lived under oppression, who wept over the city. With infinite love, he granted the people your life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus had a meal with his friends. And at that meal, he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and he gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, the new promise in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of every sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering his death, we cry out, "Amen."
Amen. Amen.
Celebrating his resurrection, we shout, "Amen.
Amen." Amen.
Trusting his presence in every time and place, we pray, "Amen.
Amen."
O God, you are breath, send your spirit on this meal. O God, you are bread, feed us with yourself. O God, you are wine, warm our hearts and make us one. O God, you are fire, transform us with hope. God most majestic, God most motherly, God our strength and our song, you show us a vision of a tree of life with fruits for all and with leaves that heal the nations. Grant us such life, the life of the Father to the Son, the life of the Spirit of our risen Savior, life in you, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. A few notes about how we will do communion. Pastor Dave and I will commune the lectern side first. Daniel will start us off coming up the center aisle. I will drop a piece of bread into your outstretched hand. If you need a gluten-free wafer, don't hesitate to ask. We do have those. You'll make your way over to a tray where there are cups of wine and grape juice. It is white wine and purple grape juice. White wine, purple grape juice. Pastor Dave will bless that cup. You can consume that and drop your cup in the bowl at the end there. A reminder for our masked folks and for our kiddos who are so patiently remaining masked, you can pull your mask down during communion before heading back to your seat. For our folks who are joining us at home, please do feel free to join us in communion. Above all else, let there be no doubt in your mind that you are welcome at this meal. Jesus made no restrictions at this table, and neither do we. This is the gift of God for the people of God. Come and eat. Amen.
Thank you.
please rise as you are able. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen.
The blessing of God, who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. Amen.
You're the body of Christ raised up for the world. Go in peace. Share the good news. Thanks be to God.